So we look to objects as evidence of the past. We must ask ourselves the question, do they tell us the truth?
What kinds of truths can objects tell us? How do we know if they're telling the truth? Can objects lie? Here we are in what looks like a room from the 1970s, but we're actually surrounded by ceramics from the 17th and 18th centuries.
Oh, would you like a piece of fruit?
Chris, that's a chamber pot.
Yeah, and that is deceptive, isn't it? There's some objects that don't intend to deceive us, but deceive us now. A great example of that is urn imagery that is found in neoclassical pottery, but also other objects. We have several urns here on the table. A great example is actually this medallion, which has a woman kneeling down, presumably mourning, because urns had always been a symbol of death. The trick about it, though, is that urns never had been used up until well after the Civil War for cremation in early America. In fact, early Americans resisted urns, and they buried all their dead in coffins. But the urn is everywhere in the material culture. And we see it also in this fire pail. And if we read it one way, you would think that urns relate to the practice of death for these people. And in fact, it's just a symbol. It's just a symbol of mourning and of a kind of a revival of a classical tradition.
Objects that remain behind can deceive us. At a decorative arts collection like Chipstone, so many of the pieces are tableware, teacups and saucers, plates, porringers, and there are so many tableware forms, some of them even resemble fruits and vegetables, like these pieces here. From this profusion of tableware, you might imagine that people in early America and early modern England had plenty to eat, because all of their tableware reflects plenty. But in fact, that wasn't the case. There was lots of hunger in these places. The museum collections can deceive us into thinking that there was plenty. This is partly a problem with the evidence, that the pieces that survive in museum collections tended to belong to wealthy people who did have plenty to eat. So this shows us how the way that collections are collected over time can be deceiving to us in the 21st century. Objects can intentionally deceive us. This plate was commissioned by a tobacconist organization in the 1680s to promote the growing of tobacco in Virginia. The plate depicts all of this plenty, all of these botanical themes, and a tobacco plant growing in the middle, as well as indigenous or enslaved people opening their arms to colonization and to the cultivation of tobacco in Virginia. So it's really a Garden of Eden scenario depicted on this plate. The actual conditions in Virginia in the 17th century couldn't be farther from that. Early Virginia was full of disease, starvation, war, cannibalism, slavery, and indigenous people resisting colonization. So that this plate presents one vision of Virginia as this lush, peaceful place that'll be great to grow tobacco. But the actual conditions in Virginia were very different. This was misleading for people of the time who were thinking about investing in the tobacco trade in Virginia or about moving to Virginia for colonists. But it also could be deceptive for us today if we don't remember this violent and difficult early history of Virginia. Some objects intentionally mislead their viewers. This jug is after the famous Benjamin West painting, The Death of General Wolfe, depicting a British general dying at the end of the Seven Years' War. What's interesting is that while the painting depicts a Native American man sitting right here, in the transition to the jug, this man has disappeared, a Native American man who is kneeling at the edge of this image. The makers of the jug could have removed the Native man for compositional reasons. However, the deletion of the Native man is more complicated than that. The Native man depicted here is a fictitious person, a Native man passively looking on as the British and French empires decided the fate of the North American continent, and with it, the fate of Native peoples in their homelands. And so this image is sort of doubly deceptive, because West chose to include this fictitious Native person at the scene of this battle, and then the makers of the jug chose to erase that person, all of it contributing to the larger erasure of Native Americans from the narrative of American history.
So we're talking about objects that may deceive us here in the 21st century, but may not have deceived those for whom these objects were made. And a great example is found in these ceramics. If you look at the bodies, you can notice that they are almost all young people, from courting couples to people frolicking in the countryside to children playing with one another. And this masks a reality that would have not been foreign to them, which is that youth was a precarious position to be in at this period. And in fact, to be elderly was to be revered, and also much more rare than it is today. And so even though there's a vision of youth and vitality and innocence in this pottery, in fact, knowledge, seniority, and respect was one of the highest aspirations of anybody in this period. So one of the things we learned about today is that objects do lie to us all the time.
But they can also tell us other truths about our past and about our present. If only they could talk.